please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Okay, so let me get straight to it. So we've been talking a lot about expenditure, we've been talking about infrastructure and many other issues. Ms. Adhia, and again I come back to the messages that we're getting on social media, especially from people saying that the budget has been unfair and unjust to the salaried class. And I know every year, we say that ye dil mange more, and of course all expectations cannot be met. But nevertheless, sir, a lot of people saying that look what the government has given by way of standard deduction. The government has taken away because you've done away with medical allowance, you've done away with transport allowance, you've brought in the 10% LTCG, you've hiked the cess from 3% to 4%. So what has the salaried class benefited from the budget, Mr. Adhia?
Well, it's not true to say that every single salaried employee is getting both the conveyance allowance as well as the medical allowance. There are many employees in the lower category of people who are not getting any one of them. So those people will get straight away the benefit of 40,000 rupees standard deduction. There are some who are getting only one out of the two, so they will also get partial benefit. And so on the whole, the benefit is okay. The pensioners, which is a big class, out of 2.5 crore people who are salaried, it also includes a lot of pensioners. In case of pensioners, there is no such benefit being given to them. So they will also gain substantially. So again, one more benefit to senior citizens we have given indirectly by way of standard deduction. As far as one person cess is concerned, what is it? If you are paying 40,000 rupees of tax, a middle class person, or even if you are paying 50,000, you are only paying 500 rupees more. That's all. It's an increase of 500 rupees. Vis-a-vis, if you are getting 40,000 rupees of standard deduction, and if you are not getting any one of these allowances, and if you are in 30% slab, you are getting a benefit of 12,000 rupees. Hmm. So it's 12,000 rupees versus 500 rupees. So it's a question of what, how do you take it,
How do you take it? You're saying that the criticism is unjustified, that you have in fact given significant relief to taxpayers. But let me then ask...
No, it's not significant. Okay. I do agree.
Okay,
it's,
you do agree.
It's not significant, it is marginal. But it's a token we are
But could you not have done more, sir? You say you want to reward the tax-compliant people. No. These are the tax-compliant people. Could you not have done more?
We are acknowledging that contribution of salaried class by giving those figures and clearly saying, okay, you are the people who are paying more to the government compared to the business class.
Yes.
Now, having acknowledged that contribution, we have given a token.
But then why only a token, sir?
It is only a beginning. We will be giving more relief only to this class of people in future.
So we'll have to wait for the next budget.
Yes.
We'll have to wait for the next budget. Okay, let me, Mr. Garg, ask you this question. And, this has again created a lot of stir on social media because the finance minister in his speech spoke about cryptocurrencies. And he said cryptocurrencies are not legal tender. And that is the stated position of the government because it's not legal tender. We understand that. But he also said that the government will crack down on using cryptocurrencies for illegal activities. Now, the question one is, if it's not legal tender, is the government going to say at some point, there is a committee that you're a part of, that you're looking into, are you at some point going to say that trading in cryptocurrencies is an illegal activity?
Let's not call them as cryptocurrencies, because that's what we don't believe that they are currency or coin.
Okay.
So we have used the expression crypto assets.
Okay.
Right, so these crypto assets are being used today, the exchanges are being set up, a lot of people are buying it, and there is a trade going on without understanding the full fundamental values of that. So what the government has stated, and this is a progressive policy statement which has been coming out. Once, a couple of weeks back, we said the government does not treat this as a currency and coin at all. Now in the budget speech, the finance minister said that we will not allow its use for the payment system and also payment of illegal
activities.
Right? That has been stated, which would mean that the government would do something to make this kind of use of crypto assets illegal, will eliminate that. Now, thereafter, the crypto assets still remain. people may view, some people may find value in crypto assets still, yeah, despite there not being any fundamental value there for many others. Mm. And that would require it to be sort of regulated in a way, so that whatever transactions takes place in crypto assets for the part which is legitimate, is regulated by the regulators, this becomes transparent.
But
and then
isn't that part already transparent because they follow the KYC norms, you know, and I understand that there's been notices that have been sent to people and there have been surveys and not raids that have been conducted. So can you explain to us what is the nature of regulation that you're looking at bringing in? Because I would imagine even the global markets are listening to what is happening here in India, because while we've seen a fair degree of volatility today, the prices of the Bitcoin, etc., have crashed quite significantly. So they are watching what India is doing as well, sir.
So the exchanges which are being set up currently are not the regulated exchanges. Nobody regulates them. They are in a way self-set up, self-regulated kind of thing. There is no legal requirement, statutory requirement for effecting certain kind of KYCs and transactions. There is no record of those transactions which is done today. So when you move to a system of regulated exchanges for these crypto assets, then you have entire trail and those things. So that is what comes when you get it traded. Imagine the securities trade outside in the Dabba trades, etc., which takes place, and securities trade which takes place in regulated stock exchanges. So that's the change which comes about when you regulate it.
Okay, so when can we expect the committee to finalize its recommendations? Because there was a previous committee as well which put out its recommendations, which was never made public. So when can we expect regulation on this front?
We hope now that within this financial year, the committee would finalize its recommendations. And then it would require legal changes. It would require regulatory assignment to be made, which regulator would do it.
So all which those, regulator will do it, sir?
So let us see, let's wait for that recommendations to emerge in the government decisions. But certainly there would be a regulator who would regulate.
Okay, so that's one big headline that's coming, that we could perhaps see a conclusion on regulating crypto assets. I'm not calling it cryptocurrency, but crypto assets in financial year 18 itself. Mr. Adhia, let me ask you now about the other big issue that has created a fair amount of consternation, sir, and that is the long-term capital gains. Yesterday, it looked like the markets had weathered the storm. Today, it was a different story altogether. And while we understand that the grandfathering has provided a certain degree of cushion, the view is that for 20,000 crores, and the 20,000 crore calculation, if again you can explain for the benefit of our viewers, because that is a question that's come our way, assumes the fact that the markets will continue to remain and move higher. But have you soured sentiment, you know, for no reason, given the fact that this is where a lot of retail investors are putting their money into domestic mutual funds, etc.?
Well, when it comes to retail investors, we already protected their interest
with the 1 lakh
by giving some kind of an exemption limit of 1 lakh. And so I don't think those people will be badly hit. Well, the whole idea of putting LTCG, the capital gain tax on LTCG, is that we should not leave one class of asset completely without any taxation. Now, if that happens, what happens is that particular class of asset becomes very, very attractive for people. And even when the valuations are not very correct, people tend to hurt towards it. And people tend to invest more money in that class of asset. So it's a potential risk also for the economy.
So were you worried about the fact that if
the stock market, I mean, we have seen for the last 5 years, the stock market gains have been very, very good. It's been very, you know, it's been upswing. Now, if you are getting more than 15% gain from capital market every year from long term, what is wrong in taking 10% out of that? We are only reducing that by 1.5% out of 15% gain if you are getting from capital market. So there's nothing wrong about it.
No, you know, it's an interesting point that you made there, sir, and I want to ask you this because the economic survey talked about the rise of the Indian stock market in the context of what we're seeing happen with the global markets as well, and it called for policy vigilance. Is this a way of the government ensuring that the markets don't get into irrational, exuberant territory?
That's one of the objectives, but the objective is also to have some revenue gain out of it. Why should we be taxing only the salaried class why should we be taxing only business people, and why should we be not taxing a class of people who are simply investing in capital market? And whatever gain they get, whether it is 1 crore or 50 crore, whatever is the capital gain through equity investment, why should we leave that class alone? That's the idea.
We've got a question here from Mr. Kanabar.
I think I would totally agree with you that there is no reason and economic justice to say that those who are investing in real estate or unlisted securities should pay capital gains tax and others should not. Two questions I would have for you, sir. First is that we have the securities transaction tax. And I think continuation of both securities transaction tax as well as imposition of long-term capital gains tax probably is not justified. That's one. And second is this calculation of 20,000 crores of taxes, because that would presume probably about 2 lakh crores of gains being realized. And if 2 lakh crores of gains are being realized, then probably at least 10 times more of those gains are unrealized. So we are looking at some astronomical number, and therefore government seems to be predicting a rather huge bull run to estimate 20,000 crores of taxes, sir.
Well, I'll answer the first question first. Look, there's a lot of people who are saying, why did you retain STT along with LTCG tax? The reason is very, very simple, that even today, with 10% long-term capital gain tax being put on the equity investment, it's a still substantially lower taxation compared to any other class of investment. Whether you take immovable property, whether you take capital gain out of debt instrument, or from any other class of asset, it is still the lowest, 10%. Secondly, the period of holding for all other assets is 2 years. And for some assets, it is 3 years still. So it is 1 year here. Thirdly, even for short-term capital gain, it is a substantially lower regime. We are charging only 15% tax on the short-term capital gain up to 1 year. While for all other asset class, it is your marginal rate of taxation. So if you are in 30% slab, it is 30%. So from all angle, it is a different dispensation. It is a it's a greater relief which is given to this sector. So what is wrong if we continue marginal gain by way of STT, which is giving us only 9,000 crore? Now that's all. That's not a major cost. 9,000 crore is not even, I mean, much less than 5% of what the capital gain people have earned in the stock market. As far as the second question of number is concerned, we have actually given you the number which people have reported, the realized capital gain, long-term capital gain in last year, based on the returns filed for 16-17 for assessment year 17-18. In the budget speech, we have given that figure of 3,67,000 crore. That is the long-term capital gain people have realized in the last year. If we presume that this will continue, the same kind of buoyancy, then it would become 4 lakh crore. So it is obvious that 40,000 crore can easily come in a normal year, but because it will be the first year where things are grandfathered, we expect only half of it to come. That's the calculation.
Okay, so you're assuming that next year onwards, and if the buoyancy continues, you could in fact see a figure of about 40,000.
If the tax market buoyancy continues like this, then we should get 40,000.
Okay, since we're talking about the markets, let me ask you about the bond markets, Mr. Garg. And, you know, statements from the finance ministry have been known to move the bond markets in the recent past. Today, we've seen some degree of stability come back to the bond market on the possibility of, or at least the announcement of an OMO from the RBI. What's your own sense of what's happening as far as bond deals are concerned? Some people seem to suggest that it's an overreaction. Some people seem to suggest that there's a technical issue. What's your own take on what's happening with the bond market?
I think, by the way, the statements from the finance ministry sometimes spook and sometimes bring a lot of cheer.
Which is why I said your statements are moving the bond market, sir.
So they do have, because the government still happens to be the largest draft on the savings in the system. But what I see from yesterday and today, and you referred rightly that today there is little more stability in the bond market. The yields actually reduced today a little bit. I think in last two, yesterday, the little bit of a spike which was seen in the yields perhaps was based on inadequate understanding of the entire gamut of the provisions which have been made in the
budget
as well as in the Finance Act. So budget numbers were perhaps understood that 3.5% this year and 3.3% next year as the fiscal deficit. But the big consolidation backed by a statutory obligation, which was brought in by amending the FRBM Act, which was there in the fine print in the finance bill, was perhaps not as clearly and as widely understood yesterday. So what the government has put out before the nation is very very solid package of consolidation on the borrowing side. We've said that the fiscal deficit would be statutorily limited to 3%
by 2021.
It might actually happen a year earlier, depending upon how the things move. In any case, we don't expect next year it to be more than 3.1% a year after that. So it would be very close to 3%. So you have a fiscal consolidation path. And additionally, this time, we taking that debt rule recommendation of the N.K. Singh committee, we have formalized that as a debt rule of 40% debt. And that's a big reduction planned in the government's overall borrowing.
Okay, so you believe that there should be now stability. But let me ask both of you, sir, on what you see as far as interest rates are concerned. We've got a monetary policy meeting coming up next week. Let me start by asking you, Mr. Garg. So long pause now, or even the possibility of a hike?
So interest rate policy decision is the MPC.
I know, sir, but I'm just asking. The finance ministry has made its view very clear over the past few months that the rates should have been brought down. So do you believe that now the space for the Reserve Bank to bring down rates doesn't exist any further?
By the way, the finance ministry has never specifically commented in last
year. Sir, the chief economic advisor has gone to the press, has stood outside North Block very publicly stating that rates must come down.
What chief economic advisor pointed out was that the real interest gap is widening, and that's a parameter for taking decision on the interest policy. But he did not, that's my judgment, he did not say, at least in last 1 year, anything about a specific rate.
No, he didn't talk about a specific rate, but he did very categorically mention that the Reserve Bank was behind the curve and that they should act as far as the rates are concerned. And the MPC is behind the curve.
And in this survey, he has said
that the case for easing is less persuasive today.
That is the economic facts which are there. The real interest have moved in a certain way, inflation has moved in a certain way. So what that data led him to believe about the real interest differentials, that's what he commented, that's fine. Okay. But the decision making now, it's by the law which the government has enshrined and given this authority
to the MPC. Yes, Anil, go ahead.
Mr. Adhia, I want to take you to a different set of markets, the real markets in the country, which is related to GST. Few hours after the FM finished his speech, the e-way bill was supposed to go live, but due to some glitches, it has been deferred indefinitely. Now, two questions here. One, the e-way bill, as you have told me personally, was a key part of the GST architecture, and it should have been implemented yesterday. So it's been long overdue. So in that, first question is, does it disrupt your GST architecture and put GST under threat? Second is, it has revenue implications too. So your own projections for the next fiscal year, not just for you, but for the entire country, do they also get impaired because of this e-way bill being deferred?
Well, if you see the approach we have taken in GST implementation, in spite of being such a sea change in the way people pay taxes, indirect taxes, we have implemented it very smoothly. The reason for this is that we are willing to change, and that flexibility which the government has shown, the flexibility which the GST Council has shown, has helped us immensely. So this is one more instance of that flexibility. Yesterday, we had announced, we had said that we are going to start the e-way bill from 1st of February. 16 states, instead of originally 13 states, had said that we will join for intrastate also. So for interstate as well as intrastate movement of 16 states, we started the system yesterday. Unfortunately, there was so much of overload in the system. There were systemic issues, and we admitted it straight away that because of technical glitch, We don't want the trade and industry to suffer. We don't want them to sit before the computer and try to generate an EV bill for 10 minutes, one EV bill 10 minutes. We want to give them an experience in which EV bill can be generated within 1 minute. Now, unless we are able to give that experience to them, we don't want to start in a formal way. So we said, let the trial period continue. It was a very difficult call. We had to immediately call all the states and we had to inform them. So we have taken that decision that immediately, right, by 7:30 or so in the evening, we have taken this decision that we will call it a learning period for everybody. And we will, in the meantime, trying to improve the technological capability. But we are committed to EV bill. If GST has to be any different from the previous regime of VAT, it is only because of these two things. One is EV bill across the country, and second is invoice matching. We have to bring back both this into the system, and we are working in that direction. So we are committed to EV bill. It will come back as early as possible. But we don't want to commit a date now.
Okay.
I want to make sure that our technology works properly.
Okay, so you don't want to commit to a date now, and largely technology letting you down on this front. But sir, since you spoke about flexibility, let me ask you a question on further rate rationalization. And we've seen every GST council meeting, even the last one we saw further rate rationalization. What more can we now expect? And the possibility, I'm asking only about the possibility of converging to a single rate, a revenue neutral rate of between 15% to 16%, as was articulated in the economic survey. Is that a real possibility today?
Well, when it comes to reducing rate from 28% to 18%, it is an easier call for us because, okay, we are losing some income, but so what? We expect that more people will comply and they will not try to avoid taxes. Because if it is 28%, people try to avoid taxes. If it is 18%, they will pay. That is the idea. So we reduced it on plywood. We reduced on many other items. Now, all these items were earlier also attracting more than 25% tax rate, excise as well as this fund put together. Now, the question is, when it comes to single rate, we have to take a difficult call of lifting up all the items of 5% and 12%. Now, is that possible? Given the reality that most of these items are consumed by common man, it would have a lot of inflationary impact on the
three-rate structure?
It is possible to bring it to three-rate structure. We can always do that. But we will work in that direction. We have already been working in that direction. Now the items which are left in the 28% category are basically the high-end automobiles, in fact, all automobiles and 28%, then cement, paints, and demerit goods. Other than that, there's hardly anything in
28%. Can cement and paint expect to be moved lower, sir?
We could think about it depending on the revenue situation. The demands are coming too soon, you know. Let us see stable revenue for at least 1 year out of GST. And the state governments are already protected because of the compensation cess. But who is going to protect the revenue of Government of India? So we have to go slow in that.
Mr. Adhia, if I can just take you back to our previous question. You talked about a technical glitch in the reason. What is the problem here? Is GSTN the problem? I mean, because this is consistently happening.
In fact, the GSTN is doing the main part of the portal, our GST portal. But this part of EV bill is being given to NIC. So GSTN has contracted NIC for this.
Okay.
So NIC is working on it.
Okay. Let me then follow up with a question on the GST, sir. You're hoping that collections will pick up. And in fact, on indirect taxes, you're assuming over 17% growth in FY19, sir. So how confident do you feel that without the danda, you'll be able to get the GST collections moving higher? Because the CBEC chief said so far, there's been no enforcement on our part, no policing on our part, but now we intend to get into enforcement mode. So without the danda and with the danda, what is the assumption on GST, sir?
No, in fact, we are getting a lot of data, and one data which we had deflected was that in the composition scheme which we have, wherein we are saying up to 1 crore, people just saw their turnover, and they just pay 1% of that. They don't get any input tax credit, or they don't have to give any input tax credit claim to others also. So it's a 1% composition scheme. You would be surprised to find that the average turnover shown by traders and the manufacturers in this category, out of so many returns which are filed in composition scheme, the average turnover is coming to 14 lakhs only. Now just imagine, if it is 14 lakhs of turnover, why did they register then? They were exempted up to 20 lakhs. So I don't know what games small traders are trying to play with us.
Small traders are playing games with you, Mr. Adhia. So watch out. That's the message there from the finance secretary, that the small traders who are playing games with the government better watch out. Yes, sir, you've got a question. Go ahead.
Mr. Adhia, sir, I have a very simple question, a very layman type of question. You mentioned that in the personal income tax, there have not been any significant changes. The question is, why do you make insignificant changes? Because probably you don't realize that making these small changes lead to a lot of time, effort, and expenses. Documents have to be changed, websites have to be updated, CAs have to understand, we all people also have to understand. Instead of making life easy, as you said, ease of living, you are actually complicating for insignificant things. My humble request to you is, in subsequent budgets or whenever all budgets take place, fix a threshold for making changes. For example, if you find that the 10% change is significant, then make 10% the threshold and don't keep tinkering with 1 or 2%. And because I find it's only a justification that some people are going to benefit by medical expenses, some are going to benefit by transport. These are too insignificant to influence the entire nation and make such changes. Thank you.
No, I take your suggestion. We should not be tinkering with the tax laws too many times. But some of it is inevitable because whenever we find there are too many loopholes and which practitioners are using, then we come up with amendments to plug that loophole. And then they find another one. Then we again plug it, you know. So that's the reason why a lot of changes take place. But I agree. I do agree with you. While we are trying to bring ease of living for rest of the citizens, the ease of living of charter accountants is being disturbed.
Mr. Garg, let me ask you, sir, because this was again an announcement made by the finance minister. Two questions. One on this business of dealing with NPAs related to the SME sector, the MSME sector that the finance minister spoke of in his budget speech. You're looking at that issue. What can we expect? What is it that you're looking at? Because is it going to be the IBC route that you take? It will be a different route. What is it exactly that you intend to do on addressing the NPA pain for the MSME sector?
I think what is intended, and our financial services department is actually handling this. The intention is that so far, the small proprietors and others have not actually been notified for the IBC. IBC provides for them through the debt tribunal's route, but those have not been specified. But that's the bankruptcy route. Mm. The additional view which is being taken about how do we help these in terms of resolution of their NPA within the banking system. Those schemes are being contemplated, designed, and debated. Very soon, the Department of Financial Services will come up with a package on this.
Okay. Let me ask the both of you then, as far as the oil math is concerned, sir. You know, crude A, I believe you factored in, what, $75 a barrel for the budget or 65? What is the calculation, sir?
For what?
For calculation crude, crude of what? Prices.
No, but for what?
No, just factoring in what the assumption will be for your oil math.
No, we haven't. We don't have to calculate the oil price for the sake of making budget. Mm. The present calculations are based on the present rates.
Okay.
So we are, if the prices of crude go up, then if there is a need in order to give consumers some relief, the government may have to think about reducing some of the excise duty. Okay. And which we have done once in the past.
Yes. And yes, Mr. Garg.
Let me explain, because I think yesterday I casually mentioned about this level of prices. In fact, on deeper examination, the oil prices don't directly enter into our calculations. We have the oil petroleum subsidy where these are indirectly factored in. So we have the LPG subsidy and the kerosene subsidy.
And there's a significant fall, if I remember correctly, from the
numbers yesterday on the kerosene subsidies.
Exactly.
Side.
So I was going to tell you that.
Yeah. So the almost 25,000, 24,000.
The kerosene subsidies are actually declining faster.
Yes.
Because there is more expansion of the LPG connections in the rural areas through the Ujjwala schemes and other. Okay. Interventions with the government.
Okay.
And kerosene as a fuel is also going out. So kerosene subsidy is a very small now, I think 2,500 crores or so. The only major, relatively major subsidy which is left is the LPG subsidy.
Yeah.
And LPG subsidy is, there is no one-to-one relation with the oil prices and the LPG prices.
Okay.
There is that disconnect. So what we have calculated as LPG subsidy is the existing level of the LPG prices. And that's more than adequately taken care of in the estimates. Now, oil prices move in a certain way. And at some stage, if it becomes uncomfortable for the consumers, and at that stage, as Mr. Adhia just said, that
bring down
we need to tweak the excise duty. That is the indirect way. So at this moment, we don't factor into anything based on direct oil prices.
Mr. Adhia, let me ask you, sir, and I'll put that question to you as well, Mr. Garg. In order of priority, list the biggest challenges and the biggest risks that you see to the budget that you've presented.
Biggest risk in the budget?
No, the biggest risks to your budget.
To our budget?
Yes.
One, of course, is the oil. Of course, that is so. In fact, reduction of crude oil price really came to a lot of our help in the year 16-17 and 15-16. These 2 years were good for us. And our indirect tax revenues were very buoyant because of the crude oil excise duty. But now that's a risk factor. We are all hoping that shale gas and oil will kick in moment the price goes beyond a particular level, but I don't know why it's not happening. Only the oil exports will be able to tell us here, you know. But we have to keep watching that situation. That is a risk factor for us.
Okay.
And of course, GST revenue, again, we are very optimistic about GST. In fact, GST revenue can really give us a lot of bonanza. But the question is that we have to fix all these technological issues so that we are able to do invoice matching as early as possible, so that the entire evasion goes. And once correct turnover is being reflected in the GST, there is no way people will be able to avoid even the income tax.
So you're saying that on the tax front, whether it's direct or indirect taxes, you have been conservative in your estimates?
Absolutely. Yeah.
You've been conservative?
We have been conservative.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mr. Garg, the number one risk that you see?
Of course, the way the bond markets behave is one thing which we, which worries us a little bit. What I see, it might be desirable from the larger economy point of view. If the credit growth picks up, the demand for money goes up, that puts pressure on the interest rates. But that's it. For the larger economy, it's a desirable thing to happen, and we'll take that into account. On expenditure, there is a very realistic budgeting, but the two programs which have not been fully budgeted, the MSP and the health insurance, at this moment we don't expect that to be too large a fiscal implication. But if it turns out to be somewhat higher than what we feel comfortable, that might be a slight risk to the budget.
So that means that 3.3 could become 3.4?
No, but we'll make sure this doesn't go beyond 3.3.
With my buoyant revenue projection, I'm saying there's an underestimation there, there's a conservatism there.
And also what I think the larger audience believes here, that we have underestimated this investment revenue. Right. That's not our estimate, but I think this is the larger perception.
That's the sense of the audience, yes, given the fact that you've exceeded it this year. Let me end then by asking both of you, Ms. Adhia, and you know, this is going to really be about stabilizing the GST this year. You know, realistically, the anti-profiteering concerns are a real legitimate concern that a lot of people in this audience are worried about. You know, can you give India Inc. an assurance that anti-profiteering is not going to be a nightmare that they are going to have to deal with in FY19?
It's not at all a nightmare. Can anyone out of this audience tell me how many of you have got notices for anti-profiteering?
I don't know if they're in the room, the ones that have got it.
You can count it by on your fingertips, how many notices have gone. And these are only first level of notices for getting first level of information. And I don't think it is already behind us. I mean, very few people are talking of profiteering, and that also mainly in the area of real estate.
Okay.
Baki to, in fact, there are companies which have come forward on their own and given us checks.
So will real estate and petroleum be included into the GST, and how soon do you believe that could happen?
That's going to take some time. It's not an easy decision for state as well as central government.
Okay.
It's going to take some time.
I'll end by asking you, Mr. Garg, do you feel confident of being able to achieve the growth number that the budget has put out?
Very much.
Very much.
I think 7 to 7.5% is a very realistic estimate. We would start seeing this level from this year itself in the third and fourth quarter as we move along. So I think we are very confident of achieving this. And more also the nominal growth. That also matters us quite a lot in terms of that. So nominal growth numbers which we have used for our calculations are very realistic.
Well, Mr. Adhia and Mr. Garg, appreciate you joining us here on the CNBC TV18 budget verdict and explaining many of those numbers to us. Appreciate your time and thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause for the Finance Secretary as well as the Economic Affairs Secretary. And may I now request V. Vaidyanathan to please join us for the vote of thanks.
Thank you.